Did not. We will be starting up again in approximately 1 minute just to give folks time to back. Okay, welcome back everybody to the New England CEPAC and folks watching the webcast. We are now going to start our policy roundtable. It feels like we have so many things to talk about. We've got an hour and 10 minutes, so we're gonna have to try to zoom around and cover a lot of ground. We're gonna introduce the members of the roundtable to you now. As you can see here, we've got some of the folks who are with us throughout the morning. We've got Samantha Bittner. We have Tom Brownlee, who gave, I believe, Tom, did you give the comment from Pfizer this morning, or was that somebody else?
No, that was a colleague of mine.
Okay, well, welcome to you. Sorry, I should have let you introduce yourself, but good morning. Can you tell us about your role at Pfizer?
I lead our state policy team and for Pfizer, specifically covering all issues related to policy. I think you were asking me, Steve, to introduce myself, but I heard someone else jump in. Yeah. And actually, pleasure to be on this panel again. I think I was on one for a previous review, so good to see you again.
Great. Likewise. Jeff Kasberg, why don't you introduce yourself?
Good afternoon, Steve. Good to see you again. Jeff Kasberg, one of the pharmacists at IPD Analytics. Review drugs for safety, efficacy, and cost, and consult with many payers across the United States, as well as manufacturers.
Okay. So as a full-time employee, just so people are aware, so IPD Analytics does business with payers and with manufacturers. Do you personally have any conflicts of interest with manufacturers or payers?
I do not.
Okay, thanks. We're also welcoming another representative from the patient community, Michelle Guadalupe. Michelle, why don't you say hi and introduce yourself?
Great. Hi, everyone. Michelle Guadalupe with National Eczema Association. I'm Associate Director of Advocacy and Access. So being part of NEA does receive grants and sponsorship awards from a variety of different industry partners, including Pfizer, AbbVie, Sanofi, Regeneron, Insight, and Leo Pharma. But in my role, I get to work on a daily basis with our patient ambassadors like Sam, and it's really a fulfilling position to have. Thank you.
Great, welcome. Catherine Heron, please introduce yourself.
Thank you, this is Catherine. You may also call me Katie. I'm Katie Heron. I'm with Eli Lilly and Company, part of our value and access organization, so supporting all of our commercial needs for our products across the portfolio. Very happy to be here today to talk about a really important state.
Thanks very much. Kyle, you gave a comment earlier, but quick say hi again.
Yes. Hi, everyone. Happy to be a part of the policy roundtable.
All right, great. Eric Schindler from United Healthcare. Are you on the line with us?
Yeah, Steve, thanks for having me. And thanks for inviting me to be here to give part of the payer perspective. I'm a clinical pharmacist with United Healthcare, responsible for the clinical review and program development for emerging therapeutics, and also involved as a director in the outcomes-based contracting for novel therapeutics such as these. And so this is, had the pleasure to join a few of these panels before, and always been a great experience and learned a lot. And I also wanted to thank Samantha for her comments and perspectives that she's been able to provide today.
Absolutely. We'll hear more from her, I'm sure, in the hour to come. We do have also from the morning sessions, we have Drs. Lane Siegfried and Jonathan Silverberg, both clinical experts in dermatitis, and Wendy Smith-Bagolka, also from the NEA. So why don't I just go ahead and jump in and frame this a bit, because What I'd like to cover first in general are the kind of clinical aspects, almost the role in therapy, because that's what payers, at least when they first sit down to think about it, they often want to know what's the envisioned role in therapy. And as we've seen the evidence, there's going to be a lot of, if you look just at the studies, people are going to probably have a hard time figuring out whether there are particular niches in which this drug might be better than that drug, or particular patient types, et cetera. So it's our opportunity to look at that and to talk about guidelines as opposed to individualized kind of treatment decisions. Then we will shift over into talking about coverage criteria specifically, reflecting on how coverage criteria are generally developed. We'll kind of walk through the list of things that go into a coverage policy and talk about how the evidence, as we've reflected on it today, might translate through into that coverage policy. We'll talk about what's been going on with dupilumab and with other autoimmune drugs. And then we'll, after that, jump into step therapy and some of the broader aspects related to rebates and future research as well. So that's a lot to cover in an hour and 10 minutes. So we'll go by quickly. And each member of the policy roundtable, you'll also be invited at the end to make a kind of closing one sentence statement. And so you can be cooking up in your mind exactly what you want to say at the very end. But we'll do that before we kind of move into the final phase of CEPAC comments themselves. Okay, well, that was a fascinating early morning in which we really benefited, as we always do, from the patient perspective and aspects of learning about the impact of severe atopic dermatitis on people's lives. Again, as I mentioned, I want to turn to the clinical experts first, predominantly here, and say, okay, you have 5 to 10 minutes to tell insurers what the specific role in therapy is going to be of these new agents, the JAK inhibitors, tralokinumab, ruxolitinib. They want to know, is it kind of the same bucket as dupilumab? Do we need to say some patients are definitely going to need this, but not that? I know from what Elaine has said that the argument's going to be we need everything at some point to have the ability to treat the diversity of patients as the course of their disease unfolds, but try to be as concrete as you can with categories of patients or situations in which, you know, the JAK inhibitors, maybe one, maybe all of them would have a special role versus tralokinumab and versus dupilumab. So role in therapy, JAK, you know, the JAK inhibitors and tralokinumab and ruxolitinib. Elaine, why don't you go first? Oh, if she's not back. Oh, no, she is. She's just, I'm sorry.
Sorry, I was on mute. I can't overemphasize that we need to have tools in our toolbox, and we need to be able to, as physicians and specialists and subspecialists, to be able to make these decisions. The number one dissatisfier of physicians now, EMR is outranked by access to medication, the amount of time that we have to spend, you know, supporting our medical decision-making for these very complex patients, to people who really can't even begin to understand how you make these medical decisions, is just very difficult. And having dumbed down step edits, and particularly, and this is my number one point based on age, makes a huge difference to the, you know, to our ability to treat patients appropriately. So, you know, we need to have, I think JAK inhibitors are a big promising category. Our targeted biologics are also a promising category. The tools that we already have, the calcineurin inhibitors and topical corticosteroids, are also needed as a basis for treatment. But, you know, we physicians have got to be able to make our decisions based on patients without being dictated to by third-party payers by some sort of a dumbed-down formulary.
All right. So noted. So the way the world works is that payers are going to try to get a lower price. And the only way they can do that is by creating tools to shift market share, either by excluding drugs from the formulary or by saying some have to be tried first, or that we'll have some differential out-of-pocket payment. Now, ICER's on record, obviously, for saying that drugs that are fairly priced that there are aspects to fair access that would suggest that they should all be on the formulary or at least have really truly functionally equivalent alternatives. But in terms of, again, if you can get more precise what the specific role in therapy are, JAK inhibitors, are they first to be used and then you would follow up with a dupilumab or tralokinumab from a clinical perspective, not an economic perspective? Or is it just kind of, there's no real way to know at the beginning which of these drugs might work best for a patient. Again, try to be as precise as you can around what's the role in therapy of these new agents as they enter in on top of dupilumab.
I'm happy to go for it, Elaine.
JAK inhibitors are a potentially more potent drug with potentially more side effects. So you have to consider the degree of suffering that people are doing, needing a JAK inhibitor as, you know, their next line prescription. I don't think anybody's going to be giving a JAK inhibitor to a patient as a first line therapy or any of these newer agents. We have first line therapies and, you know, all of us who take care of these patients are willing to use our first line topical therapy for every patient. But JAK inhibitors have a role to really put the fire out, but not necessarily as much of a role for, you know, long-term therapy. Whereas biologic agents, I think, have a real indication for people who have chronic lifelong disease who are going to need a way to control their disease and are particularly important for people with panatopy, not just skin disease, but also lung disease and gut disease and, you know, sinusitis and things like that. So they're all important. The decision-making is very difficult and it's important to have as much of a toolbox as we can.
Okay, John, go ahead.
So I'll get a little more into the weeds. I was going to jump into the weeds, and then I was so happy that Elaine gave that statement. So I said, maybe I can get away with not going into the weeds, but now you're making me go into the weeds. So I think, you know, the first thing is, that I would ask is really to try to stay at least on label with how it was studied in the trials, in the sense that, you know, in the dupilumab studies, you did not have to fail 5 immunosuppressants to get into the study. And yet when it first came into the market, some payers were brutal. I mean, absolutely brutal, to the point where we had patients suing the insurance company with the state insurance board and winning. And it's funny when a neurologist is overturning, you know, the prior authorization process. But getting into, so I think topical steroid failure for the systemic drugs and probably even for ruxolitinib, if you wanted to curb its use and not use it as a first line, I would argue it could be used as a first line.
I'm going to get into the specific criteria for each drug, but in terms of just their role in therapy.
Sure. We can talk about
it. So, for instance, I mean, are these all, would a clinician say, I can use dupilumab first for everybody clinically?
No. We'll talk about subsets then.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, within that bucket of moderate to severe, we can stratify moderate versus severe in of itself. Some of those stratifications are somewhat arbitrary because even patients who are moderate will have periods of severe disease. So I think its severity itself is less important as probably in this case, more about temporal course and past treatment treatment failure. And I know you don't want to talk about specifically step-throughs, but it is relevant at least from a niching and subsetting perspective.
Yeah.
In terms of the temporal course, I mentioned in the morning session, you have patients who are moderate to severe 365 days a year. You have patients who are moderate to severe 1 month or 2 months out of the year. Those are entirely different patients. I would argue clinically, why am I putting a patient on 12 months of biologic therapy, whether that's Dupi, whether that's Trelo? Why would I do that if I'm trying to control 1 month or 2 months of severe disease a year? And most patients, and I think providers would agree. Now, there may be scenarios where even there a patient is appropriate for dupilumab. Elaine mentioned about the asthma and other things. We can come back to that. So there is a need for intermittent therapy in the systemic realm for some patients. Even for patients who are biologic eligible, then there's a choice. Would I use dupilumab? Would I use an oral agent? And there's the value of an oral therapy. Many patients are reluctant to using syringes. Many are just truly needle phobic. And so given the choice, they're going to prefer an oral option. Now, which oral option you make preferred would then, right, we can get into specifics. So I think the oral preferential patient even with chronic disease, may choose an oral option. And they may choose to think about dose flexibility, dose titration, things like that, and not staying on therapy long-term. First question I get out of most patients' mouths with dupilumab therapy is, how long will I have to be on therapy for? And I kind of have to give a cheeky answer of, well, as long as you need to be, because right, we don't really have exact guidance on how to stop these biologic therapies. So an oral may be more appealing to some clinicians and to some providers. And so that's an important subset. I think there's also, even patients who are on dupilumab, some experience flares that are severe enough that they require rescue therapy. They might need something like an abrocitinib or upadacitinib or even a baricitinib as a way of controlling those kinds of flares intermittently and having a biologic for maintenance. Now, that's an expensive combo, I realize, but it's something that could theoretically happen. And then the other niche, I think, which is a very important one, is even for patients who, you know, we talked about the uncertainties about risk. You know, some patients, how are we going to have that conversation about MACE and VTE, et cetera? And the risk-averse patient and clinician by default is may land on dupilumab as the first-line systemic agent in patients with chronic disease. And dupilumab is a great drug, but it's not 100% effective. And we have plenty of patients who unfortunately have failed dupilumab. So as patients who do fail dupilumab, the JAKs are a logical next step. Tralokinumab could be as well, right? We cycle through the biologics in the world of psoriasis too, but I think the JAK inhibitors, all of a sudden our risk threshold changes if they've already exhausted other options. And we become much more open to risk when we have literally nothing else to use. I would argue we would take the risk on even before going through dupilumab. So I certainly would not want to see dupilumab as a step through. And I don't think it makes sense, but before all the different subsets we talked about. But I think risk would become less of a conversation when I have nothing else. And we have data to show for both upadacitinib and for abrocitinib head-to-head with dupilumab superiority on efficacy and showing efficacy even in patients who are, in the case of abrocitinib, who are non-responders to dupilumab. So those would be some high-level subsets, and there's probably even more than that.
All right. No, that's very helpful. The one last area that I think is going to be really tricky for payers and others to figure out, and so from a clinical perspective, ruxolitinib, you know, mild to moderate, obviously overlaps with moderate to severe. And so people are going to be wondering, do we try to get by with, you know, just the kind of topicals and then jump to a dupilumab, for instance? Wouldn't that be more like a moderate patient? So help us understand from your perspective what the role in therapy of a treatment like ruxolitinib is going to be, ideally kind of targeted towards.
I can take that. So, you know, ruxolitinib, just like the topical calcineurin inhibitors, just like crisaborole, are steroid-sparing agents. And the labeling, in my mind, doesn't reflect the way that we use it clinically. It reflects a shortcoming of clinical trial design. We use topical corticosteroid-sparing agents either in areas where use of topical corticosteroids, you know, poses some increased risk, like on your face or on your skin folds, but mostly it's they're steroid-sparing agents. So for people who can't stay clear using a safe amount of topical corticosteroid, you add a topical corticosteroid-sparing agent. And ruxolitinib, you know, may have risks that are different from the topical calcineurin inhibitors. Only time will tell about that. But I think it's in that same bucket. And then in terms of, you know, just as an entire global look at this whole spectrum of conditions, you can really think about it in terms of comparing it to psoriasis. And we have now about 20 different agents to treat psoriasis, and they're all useful in their own ways. There's a lot of overlap between them, but if you just take the oldest ones, the topical the TNF alpha inhibitors, you know, we have three major ones that we use. They're all a little different in terms of their risk and their benefit and what's going to work and, you know, for which patient. And so, again, I can't overemphasize the need for having different tools in our toolbox. And you have to just understand, you know, how we treat patients in general. We start with topical corticosteroids. If you're using too much and they're not holding you, you add a steroid sparing agent. If you can't do that, and there's a lot of reasons for topical treatment failure, then you move on to a systemic treatment. And the choice of the systemic treatment depends on what people's associated morbidities are, you know, what their access to medicine is, what their steroid or their needle phobia is, you know, how adherent they can be to topical medicines, how they tolerate the side effects of topical medicines. Yeah, and medical decision making is very, very difficult, and hopefully we'll be left to the physician patient team to be able to do that, as opposed to being imposed by the payer as much as it is now. And again, you know, like the on label, as Jonathan mentioned, you know, that you can start with on label based on the data that we have. But I can tell you that that completely excludes the biggest population of atopic dermatitis sufferers, which are the children.
All right, great. Let me jump to the payers, actually, as we start to pivot towards more issues around coverage. I just want to ask you to kind of reflect broadly before we get very specific. But I can imagine, you know, when we looked at dupilumab, it was obviously the first in a space in which there are a large number of Americans who would say that they have atopic dermatitis or eczema. And so it represents a real challenge, if you will, both to clinicians and to payers, to try to figure out if this is kind of like an iceberg effect where we've got the majority of patients, maybe the vast majority, are going to be adequately managed with less expensive, less intensive treatments. How do we shape the system so that appropriate access to the more expensive and maybe more effective treatments are there appropriately for the patients who need them? And there's never going to be one line you can draw across that iceberg where everybody above it needs those treatments and everybody below it doesn't. It's going to be always, especially at that gray zone in the middle, it's going to be kind of full of friction. But we have some experience with this. We have psoriasis, for instance, with now lots of different biologics and as options. And I wonder, from a payer perspective, what would you hope that we can achieve as far as the best that we've learned from our experience with psoriasis and maybe some of the other autoimmune conditions, and the worst? What are you worried about the most as you see a large number of new treatments come in to potentially treat a patient population that could be very, very large? Eric, do you mind if I ask you first?
Sure, Steve. So I think how I've thought of it, or, you know, whenever, you know, when dupilumab just came to the market, going back in time to 2017. Now, first off, I just want to add, any like critique I have either in the evidence or in the models, it is not targeted to any of the patients on the spectrum of disease on the very severe side that we've heard of. And so whenever I apply this to what we've seen in the 3 to 4 years with Dupixent, what we've seen over the course of 5 to 10 years within the biologics in psoriasis, is you see a transition and a preponderance of use that shifts to the more moderate size, mild, you know, potentially mild disease, because even though it's talking about, there is no objective measurement of what that spectrum of severity. And so it goes to the eye of the beholder, so to speak. And so, you know, when dupilumab was approved, you know, we expected a warehouse effect of patients with significant unmet needs. And, you know, you expect a quick uptake of that. And then, you know, you expect some similar uptakes over the years, but then a potential leveling off leveling off over a period of time. And I think what we have seen and what many payers have seen is you saw, you know, a potential warehouse effect. You see a continual increase. And then whenever you look at, you know, the new patients who start, if you go in and you look at, you know, available claim evidence, medical records, you do not find topical corticosteroids within the you know, 2-year pre-index. You don't see topical calcineurin inhibitors. You don't see any topical therapies that are, you know, again, listed in the label for the product. So that, I think that's the concern. And I have no concerns for the treatments of the severe patients. They need treatments. It's the transition of the preponderance of use being on the patients who may have not tried things that have been recommended by the speakers today.
So what do you think payers, from their own attempts to manage treatments for psoriasis, which I don't mean to over focus on psoriasis, but it's obviously somewhat easy to make a connection between the two and the way that people think about treating it and in some ways in the development of new treatments. Have there been things that you've tried as a payer that you say, well, that sounded good on paper or sound, looked good, but we decided, well, we tried it and it really blew up because there were way too many patients who didn't seem to fit the criteria we designed? Or like, what are some of the lessons learned that you would want to apply to atopic dermatitis as it starts to get more treatments?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are lessons to be learned there. And I think how we got there, we may talk about later in the panel, but how we got there was kind of in some of the infancy of biologics, and there wasn't necessarily managed care tools or, you know, the toolbox that they desired to. And then it coupled with a period of time of that armamentarium was consistent in its in the strategy of not much, there's not information on switching across therapies, you know, and there wasn't really a market competition that we've seen in other disease states. So I think those are all things that within psoriasis we learned as we went, and you know, now that we're seeing a condition that's not in its infancy, it's been around for a long time, but as it transitions into specialty pharmacy and biologic medications like this, we see a lot of similarities and a lot of, if you kind of compare trajectories from 10 years ago to now, we're seeing a lot of the same trends.
Yeah, and I guess just to put some scope to it, I don't know, Pat Gleason sometimes trots out these numbers, but autoimmune, I mean, I don't know if you guys have done your own actuarial kind of estimates now for what atopic dermatitis is going to look like in a few years, but do you have any reflections again on the history of how the spending, I guess, for things like psoriasis have changed over time? What are you expecting to see in atopic dermatitis?
I would say the curves would be pretty superimposable if I had to put a guess to it.
Yeah. And autoimmune at least is either number one or number two spending area for all drugs in the US, right?
I think that's a safe assessment.
So there's a checkered history, and we're gonna, believe me, get to step therapy and some of the other things too. As we start to pivot to patient eligibility criteria, this part's gonna seem pretty dry to some people, but I want to kind of walk through the way an insurance coverage policy looks on paper. And it's kind of, you know, when a doctor calls in or submits something to get coverage, the kind of the steps that will be walked through to see if the patient is eligible for coverage, and kind of walk through some of the kind of perspectives that we want to lend, or kind of advice, if you will, in a sense of how people can think through those. Even before I do that, I just want to quickly look back, because in a procedural way, what payers and others do is to start by looking both at the clinical trials, but also at clinical guidelines. And you know, Jonathan and Elaine, you may have no role at all with the American Academy of Dermatology, but as you know, the most influential, in a sense, the primary specialty society that would have a voice on this, has a guideline last developed in 2014. To this date, there is not another statement from the American Academy of Dermatology on how to manage moderate to severe atopic dermatitis. And when a health plan anywhere in the country wants to go look to see what the best experts in our country have to say, they see cyclosporin, they see methotrexate as the end of the line and all being kind of adequate and acceptable treatments. So we are certainly going to want to make a recommendation, I think, in our policy documents that the specialty society step up and work with patients and others to update these approaches to give guidance, not only to clinicians, but to the broader kind of ecosystem, because it's something that has been sorely lacking right now, at least in atopic dermatitis. Do you guys have any perspective on why it's been so long before the specialty society has chosen to update its guidelines?
So I'll start with the good news. It's coming. It's in the works. It's a few months away. And they will attempt in as much as they can based on the evidence to incorporate the new drugs. The challenge is it's an incredible amount of work. I mean, it's an extraordinary amount of work with a lot of folks who are helping behind the scenes. And then on top of that, the Academy is, even though dermatology isn't the biggest field in the world, the Academy is a fairly hierarchical structure that requires a lot of oversight. So it's a painful process, but we'll get it soon. And, but you know, the challenge with guidelines, at least in the dermatology realm in general, is that they tend to be more, you know, because they're evidence-based, they're going to say, oh, here's all your options, right? Here's all the things you could do, which, right, we would agree. They're not going to start higher, you know, really step therapies and hierarchies, et cetera, and giving that kind of pragmatic advice. And in all fairness, we don't have studies that have answered those questions. Like what should be, what do you do as your best second line therapy or third line therapy? So there's only so many questions they can answer, but you know, we will have at least evidence-based recommendations, including the new therapies, hopefully as well.
Good.
But they do tend to be broad because it's very difficult to make specific statements and specific step edits because the clinicians that are participating in these processes know how complicated it is to do medical decision-making for these patients.
Right. Don't know. Totally understood. It's not like a clinical guideline can solve everybody's problems, but it, in a sense, it creates a problem when it's so far out of date that it leaves a whole class of drugs kind of terra incognita when payers and others go to develop their own policies. And obviously they talk to experts as well, and we would hope they talk to patient groups also. You know, Wendy or Michelle, do you guys know if the patient groups have any specific role in helping to promote updating guidelines, the patient perspective, et cetera? Wendy, why don't you go ahead?
Right. Yeah. Sorry. Happy to comment on that. So we have had conversations with both the American Academy of Dermatology as well as the American Academy of Asthma, Allergy, and Immunology, who is also in the process of developing an updated guideline for atopic dermatitis. And we have a number of patient representatives as well that are participating in the Quad AIs guideline. And we're continuing to work with both organizations, or will like to continue to work with both organizations, to figure out ways that we can sort of translate those recommendations into information that will be helpful for patients as they engage in that shared decision-making conversations with healthcare providers.
Great. I'm glad there's a two-way street there. There should be. Okay, so now, having identified why there is certain kind of latitude, if you will, for payers to need to come up with this, it's also linked to the FDA label. You know, when they use terms like approved for patients with moderate to severe atopic dermatitis, that, you know, allows a payer to decide, well, I could let any clinician decide on their own. I could try to create criteria based on what came from the clinical trials and which patients were eligible to be in the clinical trials. You know, I can do some combination, talk to clinical experts, et cetera. But, you know, we've looked at this area before, and we are actually pursuing a research project ourselves to look at formularies, actually the top biggest 15 in the country, and see how they cover drugs like this, including dupilumab. So I'm going to run through the way that these coverage policies look and just kind of quickly pose questions about whether there's certain things we want to call attention to. Obviously they all will have an age range at, you know, the lowest age at which something will be covered, and that usually matches the label. It's rare for them to deviate from the label, but sometimes they do. The one I wanted to focus more on was, again, that first step of just the diagnosis itself, moderate to severe atopic dermatitis. Now, almost all of the plans, PBMs and others, use the same language. It generally comes from the clinical trials, and it's that the affected body surface has to be greater than or equal to 10%, or, and many of them say, or crucial body areas, hands, feet, face, neck, scalp, et cetera, are affected. So there's a fair amount of leeway, if you will, for deciding what moderate to severe atopic dermatitis is. Clinical experts, is there any further guidance you would want to give on ways that you think that should or should not be defined that would be helpful from your perspective?
I think the carve-outs for special sites are very important, and I'm glad to see it. It's not always the case, but when it comes up, it's important because you know, the sometimes patients, you know, even when they have full body involvement, that may fluctuate, but hands and face might persist and become a very concerning issue that's refractory to topical therapy. So I think that's important. I think one thing that's sorely neglected is the itch part of the story. And, you know, and I know it's hard. I know everyone's always concerned about using a PRO for entry criteria, but there are patients who have, you know, extensive milder lesions, but are just 10 out of 10 itch and almost suicidal from their itch. And that's often neglected when there's only attention towards an IGA scale or an EASI score or something along those lines.
Forgive my ignorance about some of these outcome measures. Is the POEM or the SCORAD, do either of those capture itch?
So they do capture itch in some respects. So POEM, the whole construct is it uses frequency of symptoms as a proxy measure of severity. So you'll have a question, how many days in the past week have you itched? And you can rate it that way. The problem is, you know, actually I don't have a problem with that, but if you use that, that might be too liberal because 5 days of mild itch is not the same thing as 5 days of brutally severe itch or 3 days of brutally severe itch. So intensity of itch matters. Intensity of itch is captured in the SCORAD. The problem with the SCORAD is as a composite measure, it has very rich information, but you know, it's so heavily weighted towards lesional severity that if a patient had mild lesions and severe itch, they may not meet any severity thresholds based on the SCORAD. So you kind of have to look at itch independently. The other outcome measure that many would advocate would be also quality of life, something like a dermatology life quality index, right? Because if you argue from a patient-centric care and patient-centric research perspective, isn't that what it's all about? And so if the patient has really got a lot of debilitation, that should be the driving factor. And again, I understand the challenges of using a PRO, but the PROs can also, for quality of life, may also be very helpful here.
So it sounds like one of the recommendations we could make is that plans, because you're right, we, by looking at the 15 biggest, we are certainly not looking comprehensively. Even within this group, we certainly may not know a lot of the different coverage policies that are out there. But it sounds like in some ways it's a best practice to certainly not include just one outcome measure as a different, like EASI. You wouldn't want to use just the extent of the rash as the sole way of qualifying for moderate to severe. You want to be, in a sense, ecumenical and accept maybe any one of these different outcome measures that have been developed, which I think many of the plans do. It's or this one or that one in a sense. But even that, I understand what you're saying is that there may still be some need for developing a better way to capture itch and some of the variations that you're talking about.
Okay. Yeah, and let me just clarify also, as long as it's a Bayesian or, but not an and.
Yes. Because
if you're going to start requiring and, then you're going to make me and many people very upset.
The other thing.
Okay, we're just about to get to the and or.
I just have to put in a word about using research tools. You know, those of us that participate in trials are very familiar with that, but the great, great, great majority of even specialists, even dermatologists and allergists are not familiar with this at all. So making those requirements of step edits is just garbage in, garbage out. And then again, you know, you stated that many policies use age range, you know, on label, you know, with some exceptions. Well, the only exceptions I've ever seen are for cheap drugs, you know, for potent topical corticosteroids that are generic and for expensive drugs, it just absolutely makes no sense. And again, you know, using lower age limits is crippling to those of us that take care of children.
All right, good. Okay, I want to move on now to what many people would call the step therapy part of it. You can call it clinical step therapy as opposed to economic step therapy, I suppose, because even the labels sometimes indicate that patients should try and not receive adequate relief from certain other treatments. But a lot of the plans, obviously partly looking at the older guidelines, will say that this should be for patients. You know, there's a large number of patients who don't need systemic treatment. So you have to start with patients who need something more. And there's a list, another list that we can do ands or ors. Cyclosporin, azathioprine, methotrexate, mycophenolate mofetil, interferon gamma. first to the clinical experts, and then I'll, maybe I'll ask Jeff Kasberg how he sees the broader set of payers looking at this. Is the best way to do it, say, you know, any one of those, any two of those, this and that? How do you think the clinical practice should consider defining patients in a sense who need systemic therapy?
I would like to speak to some of nonsensical step edit recommendations that I've seen, you know, for example, failing a drug like Eucrisa before you can use a drug like Dupixent absolutely makes no sense at all. With regards to the historic medicines that we use, azathioprine, Celcept, cyclosporine, methotrexate, I think, you know, there's lots and lots of data supporting that most people use either cyclosporine or methotrexate. So including those other two, while there's some patients that might go to that, you know, if you want to make broad policy, I think you don't need to necessarily include those. But, you know, for companies that are basing their recommendations on what we have data for and labeled data for, to require a step edit for cyclosporine or methotrexate that doesn't really have anywhere near the excellence of the data also makes absolutely no sense.
I would have to agree. I think, you know, I would advocate, as I said before, stick with failure of topical therapy, and then we could talk about the ands or ors there too, but and not requiring step through a systemic altogether. They're unapproved agents. They come with their own toxicities. And the truth is they don't work all that well. Azathioprine or methotrexate are not particularly effective at all, even when you really jack the doses up. Cyclosporine does work, but we know about the limited window of time that it can be used. I think if there is a step through, one thing required for systemic, and again, let me reiterate, I'm not a fan, but if it were to be required, I would say one drug only. And specifically recognizing though, that I may have a patient who technically does fine on cyclosporine in the sense that they do well for 6 months and they're clear. But I still have to follow the FDA recommendation as best I can to get them off of that. And so at that point, even a treatment success with cyclosporine requires me to switch to another therapy. So don't require an EASI of 16, which I've seen this, on cyclosporine. That doesn't make any sense, right? Even when patients do well, they might be clear, but I have to get them off of it. So then I would switch them to a dupilumab or something else. And so I think if, you know, be rational in how this would be done if you're going to require it.
Okay. Actually, one last question in that set. Phototherapy is often included in many formularies as one of these potential steps, if you will, before dupilumab. And I assume that that's in the guidelines. I assume you guys would consider that to be evidence-based treatment to use phototherapy as a potential step before dupilumab and potentially the JAKs?
I mean, it's not in the American Academy of Dermatology guidelines, but then again, dupilumab's not there. It's considered that it could be done. I mean, we have to recognize we're talking about health equity and access. Phototherapy is available to a very teeny, segment of the population. Rural patients, non-existent. Patients who cannot take off from work, not an option. Anyone who travels for work, not an option. And anyone with severe disease, not an option. It is something that will flare them up initially. It is not potent enough. It takes too long to work. So phototherapy is a great option for some patients, but it really should be left to that shared decision-making. To require that as a step through may mean 6 months of delayed control of disease, which is just unfair. And we've had patients where they were forced to step through phototherapy, knowing it would flare them, but having no choice. And then they had flares in one case leading to hospitalization for their atopic dermatitis. So, you know, again, if you're going to, it's a less risky therapy to require step through, but from an efficacy and an access, there's no way I could in good conscience say that this should be the step through before an advanced other advanced therapies.
Okay. Let me jump to Jeff. Jeff, I assume you may have taken a look at some of your data from working with payers around the country. How do you see them both kind of the way they've currently covered dupilumab and how you think it might evolve in this sense of using a kind of a clinical step through these other systemic therapies? Do you think that's going to continue to be the case, or are some plans going to jump from topicals to biologics?
you know, earlier in the discussion, there was talking about when it first came out that it was tough to get. So you're correct. As I was sitting here, I've been looking at the criteria for the top 7 to 10 payers, and you know, Dupixent is not hard. It's the criteria is not super complex. There are a few payers with the phototherapy or the systemic products mentioned, but primarily those are ors, so they're not required. So there's not an and, so you're not required to do photo or systemic. I think most of the criteria I'm looking at right here is, you know, the trial of one or two of the moderate to higher potency topicals along with the calcineurin inhibitor. So I think overall access to Dupixent right now nationally is pretty good. Did you want me to talk about where the JAKs would fit in?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
You know, I think that the JAKs are excellent, you know, like fast therapies, but does that fast onset, does that mean a lot? Are we splitting hairs? Is, you know, a couple of weeks here different? But I think that the JAKs in general will fit in similar with similar criteria to where the interleukins are. I think that you'll have similar criteria for the JAKs that you do for Dupixent. You may find a few payers that try to step the JAKs after the interleukins because of cost, and we'll probably get into that cost discussion. But that may be different due to other issues like current formulary status of Rinvoq or Olumiant on other therapies. But I would say the access won't be a lot different than current Dupixent access.
All right. Kyle, I'll let you jump in if you want to from Sanofi, because I know you will have your own view on how payers are treating Dupixent out there. I'm staring at our own data from the top 15, and I am seeing a fair number of ones that go from topical straight to Dupixent. And we all know that when you did announce your initial price for Dupixent, it was in part a call to payers to respond to responsible pricing with a responsible approach to access. Do you think you got it?
Steve, I'd say we got a response. It wasn't as, it's always open to some interpretation. I think what we are pleased by is the recognition of the transformative value. And I think we attribute, you know, what you've characterized and others have as good access, you know, according to that. What we remain concerned about is the disproportionate role that rebates seem to play in this overall process. You know, as advocates of a holistic value assessment and being as transparent as possible, as you know, in terms of how we participated in this process by providing ICER with information that other companies wouldn't with regard to our net pricing, that's all in an effort to figure out the answer to this and to take a bigger step towards a much more sustainable system than we have today as it comes to list pricing and the lack of transparency around it.
Good. That's a reminder that we will be coming to the rebates. I decided to hold that for dessert of our meal today. So we'll get there. It's one of the things that's making me make sure that we move rapidly through this section. I'm almost going to just make a quick comment because we will make some note of this in our policy recs, but even in looking at what could be considered the simpler issue of whether patients should be have a trial of topical corticosteroids, some payers require seeing that in the claims within the last 14 days. Others, it can be any time in the last 180 days. So there's a huge amount of variation just in minor things. It might seem minor, but can actually, I'm sure, lead to a lot of hassles for patients who have had trials of corticosteroids and are ready to move on to something else. A couple of the things that come up in coverage policy, one is continuation of therapy. So expensive drugs are usually approved for something like 6 months only or 12 months only, and then something has to happen. Either the patient has to have demonstrated benefit or some follow-up test has to be done to show that they're not having side effects or something to get the kind of coverage renewed. What I don't know is exactly how the plans are administering this. And Eric, maybe you can tell us in your case, but in general, what is best practice for this continuation of therapy? Should it just be a doctor ticking the box saying, yes, the patient is getting adequate kind of control or relief? Should it have to be submitting documents on the EASY or all of the other kind of outcome measures that we've talked about? What would be a good approach for us to recommend for payers to use at that continuation of therapy pivot point?
Yeah, I would say contrary to popular belief, we try not to put unnecessary barriers in the process. You know, we had discussions early on, and like Dr. Silverberg talked, you know, there are potentially EASY thresholds. But we understood that itch plays a component, and it's not just a rash component and percentage body surface area for a definition. And then applying that to a patient already on moderately effective therapy would define it. So we acknowledge early on that baseline and follow-up EASY scores, DLQI changes was not something that would add to the screening criteria of treatment at 6 months or 12 months after initiation. So our process is we rely on the physician expertise, the specialist taking care of there, and it is an attestation that they are receiving benefit from the drug. So I do not envision many physicians, you know, saying, going to us and saying, yes, we want to refill this prescription and no, this drug is not providing benefit. So yeah, it is a physician attestation of benefit for at least for within our criteria.
Okay. Michelle, please. I saw your hand raised. I hope it was not too long ago. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh no, I just put on, I just wanted to share that, you know, being part of Mia and having, you know, just these conversations with our patient population, hearing from them firsthand, you know, many times having the barriers to get on the medication, that can be a pretty lengthy process, as we all know. There are issues once they are on the medication that, you know, they will kind of that, you know, some of them will get those either letters in the mail or others that we got to do prior authorization again. There's that fear, we have some caregivers, the fear that their child is going to be taken off of a particular, you know, of the biologic. So I know that's, you know, just wanted to kind of point that out that, you know, so much goes into the whole process of getting on therapy, but many of our patients, that's not it. You know, they know that down the line, some of these barriers will come back into play.
Good. I'm actually going to raise one of those very soon too, another potential problem that, again, dermatitis hasn't had because there's really only been one biologic, but I'll come back to that in a second. So continuation of therapy, Jeff, from your perspective, looking at the broader set of plans, do we agree with Eric that basically very few are going to make any kind of major document kind of submission process or other hassle factor at the continuation of therapy phase?
I agree. Attestation is the common. One thing I did notice in looking at national criteria is for Dupixent, it seemed to be a little shorter initial approval, like a 4 month period. I didn't see an initial 6 or 12. I saw a 4 to 6. So for Dupixent, it was a little quicker.
Okay. So this, yeah, sometimes that happens when a drug is brand new and it takes a while for that to shift later on. Also quickly, I wanted to wonder from you, Jeff, do any plans allow PCPs, primary care docs, to prescribe this, or is it all restricted to specialty providers?
Majority have requirements of specialty providers, yes.
Majority.
I guess for some payers where there wouldn't be availability, I think there's allowances, but most do have specialty requirements.
Okay. One general pattern is to say, or primary care in consultation with a specialist. In some health plans, they will include that language. Is ruxolitinib going to be a special kind of situation here? Is that going to be one where folks are going to think, oh, that's okay for primary care, even though it's a JAK, it's a topical? And you know, we heard that we still don't know, obviously, everything about the risks that the FDA is looking at. But from clinical experts, do you anticipate that being a primary care delivered drug or specialty delivered drug?
I mean, in theory, it could be, you know, it's studied for mild to moderate. That's the bulk of that is going to be managed in primary care. If it was priced well, you know, then I don't know why I wouldn't use it as a first line instead of topical steroids. But, you know, I think it's probably going to be the other folks on the call who are going to determine where I have access to it, depending on the price point. And so I think it's probably going to be the price that dictates that question. But medically speaking, yes, the primary care docs should be able to use this, provided that they stay with the body surface area caps and use it the way it was studied.
Okay. Do the payers, you're familiar with expensive topicals. It's nothing brand new. But as you look at ruxolitinib coming in with the potential for it to be used in a much broader population of mild to moderate, would you envision it being used in, not in lieu of corticosteroids, but after corticosteroids, or would you actually envision it being used after methotrexate, cyclosporin, and systemic treatment, phototherapy? Would that be required before you could get a topical like ruxolitinib? It may all depend on what you think the price point is going to be, but what do you guess about the approach that payers will think through when they do see ruxolitinib?
From our perspective, at least with UnitedHealthcare, we do not place oral cyclosporin, methotrexate, azathioprine, or any of the orally administered immunosuppressants in any type of preferred requirement before any of these new therapies, and would not expect that to be for ruxolitinib. I think, the decision of whether it's first line topical versus second line topical steroid sparing, I think that's still to be determined. Never requiring a cyclosporin trial before a product like this or a product like Dupixent or any of the others to come.
Okay, moving into getting closer and closer to step therapy, my way to kind of merge into that is to talk about grandfathering, which links back to Michelle's comment. Grandfathering is when a patient changes insurance companies and they've been on one autoimmune drug and the new payer has a different kind of contract that would favor a different drug. And so the choice is whether to allow the patient to continue on the drug that they've been using and grandfather them in, or to make them switch to the new plan's preferred drug. So this is an ongoing issue in coverage for psoriasis and for some of the other autoimmune drugs. We've heard of recent efforts to consider paying patients to switch drugs. That's kind of an attempt to ask them to opt out of grandfathering. Let me start with Eric again. I'm not saying whether you will or won't grandfather some of these new, dupilumab, I guess would be the, you'd have to say that they're on dupilumab, but you get a better deal with tralokinumab. Do you think plans are going to start to do grandfathering, or will they decide, we've seen what happens with grandfathering in psoriasis, we are just not going to allow it from day one with atopic dermatitis? Anyway, what do you think is going to happen?
Yeah, so a couple of things, and one maybe semantics and show documenting maybe some training, but we try to use the phrase continuation of therapy because we understood in the last few months grandfathering has some kind of connotation or origins in some phrase that's not necessarily inclusive or diverse. So we try to say this continuation of therapy, but I think the plans how we deal with patients transitioning from other payers to there is we, and how we have addressed biologics in the past is that we have had an allowance for a continuation of therapy. I think that that's likely to probably continue. I think what you reference in maybe some of the places doing the various patient incentives may be more targeted to biosimilars. So, somewhat identical or close to identical products, but I think there's more to come. But I think the probably next 12 to 18 months would probably have some allowance for continuation of therapy and not necessarily endorse a non-medical switch at this time.
Okay, great. Jeff, I'm going to you quickly again, because we're getting to the rebate question basically, but let's assume that in a few months we have a treatment space that has abrocitinib, baricitinib, and upadacitinib as PO options. We've got tralokinumab and dupilumab. You've got all these treatments. What's going to happen with economic step therapy? Do you envision the plans doing just what they've done with psoriasis and basically saying between tralokinumab and dupilumab, we're going to pick one and either exclude the other one or at least have a preferred option that you have to try first? How do you think that will happen? And then what do you think will happen with the JAK inhibitors in terms of, will the plans want to view this as a one before the other, or will they actually want to see them as somehow simultaneously available to physicians and not make them step through one class to get to the other class? What do you think is going to happen?
Great. I'll just take them one by one for the topicals. So for the Ruxo, I would say that would be added, and you know, different mechanism of action. So I do not see access for that product to be significant. I would say, you know, there'll be step therapies without a doubt. You know, if you Chris is $8,000 a year, this would come in at that or higher in price. So there will be access, but step therapies. On the interleukin side with Tralo, I think that, you know, Leo may face some access challenges. Dupixent's well accepted, safe. The doctors have a long history with it. So, you know, if there would be some negative ramifications and adding a second IL to the, you know, I know the Sanofi person on the call doesn't like rebates, but if there would be negative ramifications of adding Tralo, then the payers may not do that, and Tralo may be used for Dupixent failures. So I think Leo has that opportunity because there's approximately 20% Dupixent failures. When you get into the JAKs, you probably don't need all of them. You know, I think Rinvoq currently has excellent access across the country in RA, and that'll play a large role. And there's also discussions about the impact of Humira and how that will play into this decision. So the problem with Rinvoq, though, is it's 50% higher in cost than Dupixent. So how are they going to do that? There's also, you know, discussions across the country right now about indication-based pricing or indication-based formularies. You know, there will be some discussions with contracting and how will that be gain access with a 50% higher cost item. And, you know, we could get into details on that. So I would say you'll probably have on the JAK side, one or two additions for atopic dermatitis and not three.
Okay. Clinical experts, again, I'm being quick. Tralokinumab and dupilumab, if a health plan wants to compete and negotiate and use the free market and says, I can get tralokinumab for half the price of dupilumab, and they come to you and they say, I'm asking you to use tralokinumab instead of dupilumab. Is that clinically okay? Is there any reason that you would feel that somehow clinically that's inappropriate and should not be advisable at all?
That is a really good question. We don't have the data to answer it until we have head-to-head studies. I don't know that we're ever going to really get there. But I think that's one way to get there. I personally think that the mechanism of action of dupilumab is enough different than tralokinumab. Tralokinumab is much more similar to lebrikizumab, but they're different. It's just a hard question to answer with no data, but I would probably, if you had made me vote, I would say that it's not a terrible idea.
Okay, and Jonathan, I'm not even gonna give you the chance to answer because I have to move on to talk about rebates. And it has to do with Jeff's comment, and I'll ask it as a question. So upadacitinib is three times as expensive as baricitinib. It is the most expensive on a net price basis across all of the drugs, at about $63,000, $64,000, according to our data. Baricitinib's net price is $19,000 to $20,000 a year. Dupilumab and the others are in the 30s, abrocitinib maybe around 40. Does our value equation, getting back to something that Dr. Silverberg said earlier, you know, we look at a lower priced drug and it has, you know, close enough efficacy that, you know, baricitinib had much better cost effectiveness. Are we going to face the issue of how rebates are going to drive the creation of the coverage protocols here? Is upadacitinib going to have a primary place, even though it's more expensive and much less cost effective because it's linked to rebates coming from Humira and other drugs made by the same manufacturer? So those of you who know how the marketplace works, and we want to, obviously we can howl at the moon all we want about rebates, but are there any recommendations we can make about what could be different? Would it be indication-specific pricing formularies? Would it be obviously something we could do in the short term around rebates that would look different? Let's address this question. And I'd open it up to any of the manufacturers, because I know I haven't had a chance to really ask any of you a question, but you're all facing, you know, competition now in a class, and you all have to both live with rebates and maybe you hate them at the same time. But let's try to generate some recommendations, some perspectives that will help the field move forward. Let me start with someone who hasn't had a chance to talk yet. So apologies because I just put my list somewhere else, but someone from one of the other manufacturers, this is your chance, Tom. Tom, what would you say would be a good policy recommendation related to how we want to get better value by linking, you know, price to the benefits to patients? What do we do with the rebate issue, and how can we make it better?
Yeah, obviously a critical question and one that we've thought about it a lot. I know a gentleman from Sanofi has already made reference to this, and many of our companies have been advocating extensively in the policy forums to try to make sure we do have some type of rebate reform, and we are absolutely committed. We've said this in public forums on the Hill and in the states that we need to move towards systems that actually don't incentivize coverage based exclusively on rebates. So our company is certainly investigating and discussions with payers about value-based contracting approaches and other such measures. But honestly, I think your question is probably, I'm not sure I can say that there's a specific answer to that, because fundamentally the industry needs to move away from the rebates, because we all recognize the problems, and it's not howling at the moon. I think this is the right time, and I think there's a lot of recognition among policymakers that we need to address it. So I will kick it back to that statement that we absolutely need to address them, and I think we're moving in that direction.
Thank you. Katie, do you have any brilliant ideas? You've got a great value. Are people able to recognize it in the market?
Well, I would like to hope so. You know, I think Lilly has actually been very vocal throughout this entire process with ICER about the importance of making sure patients have access to a wide variety of therapies in this heterogeneous disease state. And we've been very vocal about inappropriate rebating implications on patient outcomes. You know, we really believe that patients who don't have access to new and innovative therapies are going to have worse patient outcomes because they're being cycled through even more things than they've had to deal with prior to starting these new and novel agents. So we've been pretty vocal on this. I don't know if I'm going to come in here with a novel policy solution, but certainly we are committed to addressing rebates and addressing non-clinical or non-evidence-based practices that are going to unfortunately limit patient outcomes, especially in a very heterogeneous disease state like atopic dermatitis.
Thanks. And Kyle, back to you if you wish to add something.
Just that, you know, I'll point to one of the ways Sanofi is doing something about it without being able to change the whole system or, you know, the type of widespread cooperation we're all talking about is in our pricing policy. We have held ourselves to limits on price increases. So this is the mechanism, and we are holding ourselves to a higher level than, you know, we would have to otherwise. And that's the way I feel that we're saying that rebates are not the answer to this problem of how to work towards a more sustainable system.
Yeah. I mean, in some ways, we've had a whole policy roundtable or forum, I should say, on this topic and tried to sort out what can be done. Plan sponsors, the employers in the country and others have to be part of a solution as well as government, perhaps. Just in terms of the ultimate instinct here is to try to get better value, but the way that it's being administered through rebates clearly sets up disincentives for appropriate pricing in some ways. And we're aware of that. And I know you guys have commented, and it hurts not just the system with cost, but it hurts individual patients with the condition, because it may mean that their out-of-pocket is not linked to the rebated price. And so they're paying a lot out-of-pocket, not really linked to a price that's aligned well with value. So we'll make comment on that in our policy roundtable. Because it is easy to look at the differential net pricing here that's already on the table and to see the role of rebates, not just in this class, but not in this indication, I should say, but across other indications, and realize that it's having a role in supporting some of the higher prices, certainly. Sam, I haven't come back to you once this whole policy roundtable. because I wanted you to say the most important thing at the end. And this is going to be the start of our going around and letting you all have your final statements. And you don't have to be the first, you do get to be the last. But I just wanted to say that thank you for being patient. And I would like to go around and ask all of the folks on the roundtable for a final statement. I apologize that that really did feel like way too little time to do justice to some of the issues, but we took active notes on your perspectives on some of the coverage criteria, the specifics of those policies. We talked a lot about the kind of specific role in therapy that might be envisioned for some of the new treatments and whether payers can or can't figure out ways to, figure out ways to make sure that they are available for patients with specific kind of clinical scenarios. And you know, we didn't really get a chance to talk too much about future research, but usually we come out of these reviews having a pretty good idea of at least where we think a lot of the needs are for longer term outcomes data. And our hats are off to the companies that invest in that outcomes research, both as it leads through the FDA process and then extending beyond. So Dupixent actually can serve as a sentinel for the field in this case, because not only were they the first biologic, but we continue to want to get that kind of post-approval follow-up to find out more about how the drugs perform and their long-term safety. So with that, let me invite you all to have your final statement. Say what you want us to have left as the important ringing sentence in our ears. I also encourage you to think of a request. Make a request of one of the other stakeholders at the table, or someone who's not even here, but frequently it's someone who's somewhere at this virtual table. What would you ask them to do, the one thing that you think would make it better for patients and for the overall system 5 to 10 years from now? So feel free to do that. And I'd like to please start with our clinical experts. So Jonathan, can you go first?
Sure. I think you got to hear a very personal story from Samantha, and recognize that unfortunately Samantha is not the worst of the worst patient out there, that this is what we see. This is real. This is not a one-off scenario, and that your decisions are really, most importantly, it's going to affect the patients. So I can talk about making my life easier as a clinician, but really what it's about is how to make sure that we get good drugs for these patients. Please, please, please grant the access in a fair way.
All right, thank you. Elaine, thanks. We're trying to keep it to one sentence, and I know how hard that can be.
Oh yeah, impact on new drug development is something that's you can't ignore. I think that it's really important to leave the decision-making mostly to a decision between the provider and patient. It's really important to understand the risks of interruption in therapy with regards to refills and continuing treatment. And so I would, and then the final thing is, and this is probably howling at the moon, but you know, if we could have some better consistency between payers, you know, short of a single payer system, I think that would be the most fair and equitable way to make these decisions.
All right, thanks very much. Manufacturers, I'll go next to you. So why don't I go back to Katie?
Sure, yeah. So, you know, I think first caveat that we don't necessarily have approval yet for baricitinib, but Lilly does believe that this is an option for patients in this disease state that is going to serve them very well. There are very few options available for patients right now. And I think the common theme I've heard throughout the day is that there is certainly a need for options, especially for the more moderate to severe patients. And we do believe that baricitinib will be able to fulfill some of that need, along with several of the other products assessed within this review. So thank you for the time.
Great, thanks very much. Tom.
Yeah, thank you again for the time. I will piggyback on this. Clearly the need for physician flexibility and decision-making process throughout, you know, any clinical decision-making process needs to be front and center. Really want to piggyback on that and emphasize it, but I think what we need to move forward with is making sure we bridge the payer and the provider and make sure the utilization management procedures are more efficient. And you asked, Steve, if we could ask for one request. We would say for all the insurers and PBMs out there, we would love to see within a shorter time period adoption of real-time utilization management protocols that use electronic systems such as prior authorization, step therapy, so people like Elaine don't have to go calling for multiple hours, sending faxes, and going back in time that far. So we'd love to ask that of you. We know you're working on it and appreciate it.
Okay, thanks. Kyle.
Thank you, Steve. You know, I've described my profession as value assessment, and when I've tried to describe what that means, I'm trying to capture what we've done for the last 6 hours. More than that, this is what constitutes very good, excellent value assessment, because we not only reviewed the years and the thousands of patients and all of the data that we had available, but we well defined what we don't know, that we need to know to make the most informed decision. The reason why I chose this profession is because of what is at stake for the patient with the decisions that are made and the evidence that we're that we generate. What we hope to never lose sight of is the first and foremost value assessment, which, Samantha, will be made by you. If we're bringing value to you and you make the deeply personal individual decision to try a medicine and to continue on a medicine, that medicine is bringing value to you. And that's why we're doing all of this. So thank you also for being a part of this.
All right, thank you very much. Okay, I'll go to the payer perspectives from Jeff Kasberg first.
Thanks, Steve. So back to Samantha, thank you for your comments. And you know, moving into 2017, we only had, we had the first product, Dupixent. Now moving into 2021, 2022, we have 7 products coming. So I think we're gonna get you some treatment there, Samantha. So looking forward to those approvals. Eventually here, we will get an FDA decision on the safety issue shortly. And the one request out to the Pfizer side, I think you guys have an opportunity here with Abro. There's no price influence. You can pick the price that you want. So, you know, you could pick a price that doesn't require a lot of rebates.
All right, good. Okay, Michelle, moving into the patient.
Hi, everyone. Really, again, I know we've all said this, but echoing my thanks to Samantha, really representing our community, you did amazing. So thank you for that. I really, you know, want for our patients not to have that dread when they go to the mailbox and they see a letter from their insurance company that has happened. I've heard that a number of times from our community. So like others have mentioned, just having more of a streamlined effort so that they can get their medications, that they don't give up if they are, you know, denied that crucial part of their recovery.
Thanks. Thanks for being with us. Wendy.
Yes, hi. So really great conversation today from everyone and just really appreciative of everything. And I'm actually reflecting on one of the first things that was said by you, Dr. Pearson, was just the excitement for and almost congratulations of how far the research has taken us in this space. And I just kind of, I sit with that because it just sort of, how exciting is it that we're actually here and able to have this conversation? We're talking about very serious things, but it actually signals a changing landscape for the atopic dermatitis community. And I do hope that from our conversation today, we're able to turn some unmet needs into actually met needs. And in terms of a challenge, you know, for everyone, as the concept of, you know, what patients can do to facilitate and help these conversations, the concept of real world data, you know, what's collected perhaps outside the clinician's office can be a help in these conversations as well. And I look forward to seeing where that information and interesting data can help to enhance these conversations in the future.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, Sam, take us out.
I just want to say thank you to everyone for listening to me and just truly, I really appreciate everyone being here and for inviting me here. I really appreciate it. Last but not least, I would just like everyone to remember that eczema does not just affect someone's skin. It affects someone's overall quality of life. And I would really appreciate it if everyone kept that in mind when making decisions and thinking of treatment plans. It truly does dictate someone's life.
Thank you. And thank you again. Someone said earlier, as an ambassador, you are par excellence. So thank you, friends. Thank you for spending the time with us throughout the day. I'll have a very final wrap-up comment, but let me hand it back over to the chair of the CEPAC, Letharios, because I'd like each member of CEPAC to have a chance to make a very brief comment. And before you do that, I just want all of the CEPAC who can come back on camera to join me in thanking our policy roundtable, because they were really, really extraordinarily helpful, obviously, throughout the meeting and this very rich, very quick, but very productive conversation around coverage, pricing, and other aspects. So thank you very much to our roundtable. Leftarios, you want to take it around the horn?
I think that we navigated through a lot of unknowns, known unknowns, and unknown unknowns.
I'm sorry. That's yeah. I apologize. After that lovely handoff, I realized that I forgot Eric Schindler completely. And I would really hate, I hope he didn't sign off. Oh, he's still there. I'm sorry, Eric.
I'm here, Steve. And now you're going to make, I have the pressure to make it worthwhile. I just want to thank the Samantha, thank the ICER research staff for this thing. You know, there's been quite an evolution over the last 3 years from the first review to this one. And I guess my comment or ask of others, from a payer perspective, we endorse anything that allows us to keep the decisions between the patients and the providers. And so I think we're getting closer. And so I look forward to that. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Sorry about that.
Oh, no worries.
Okay. Leftarios, now back over to you.
So two hopes that I would like to express. Number one, I hope that these advancements will benefit everyone in society. And even those who are not insured this time will be able to benefit. And my other wish is to see Samantha as a surgical tech and to hear that she succeeded in that dream at some point, thanks to these new treatments. Thank you.
Great. I guess I can go around the CEPAC and just invite you guys each to make your final statement. I'm just going to go in the order in which I see you folks on screen, so I will try to get it right. But Tara, may I start with you?
Sure. Yeah, thanks for this. Was a really great discussion. I just wanted to say that I was really struck by the heterogeneity in this disease. And I think that is maybe a call for manufacturers and those that are collecting real world data, is that I think we really need to understand better the variability in how patients respond to these treatments and the variability in benefit. And by doing that, you know, we can really target these drugs to really bring the most benefit to patients and also provide the highest value by better targeting them.
Great. Thanks very much. Rob?
Thanks, Steve. Samantha raised the issue of trust when talking about some of the treatments that just have not worked for her. I found myself wondering about trust when David was talking about the FDA and its decisions around the JAK inhibitors, and in light of recent decisions that I think have raised some issues of trust. I think it really behooves our regulators and the FDA to make sure they don't squander that precious commodity here.
Great, thank you very much. Chris Jones.
Thank you. So I could not have said it better than you, Tara, in terms of the need to better understand the heterogeneity of everything. And just wanted to thank you, Steve, and all of the CEPAC members for bringing such a broad background, to conditions such as this one. I guess I'm just left thinking, wow, you know, how do we prepare in the post-COVID world for access issues like this, and for better understanding the individuality of patients, including through remote settings. So thanks again.
Thanks very much. Rebecca.
Hi, and thank you for a thoughtful day. I'm struck too by what Tara mentioned about the heterogeneity of this illness. And for me in this policy discussion, it was an important reminder as we think about that heterogeneity as a cautionary tale for how we apply step therapy. We heard again and again, we need a lot of tools in the belt. And I think for patients and their caregivers, as we talked about robustly today, we've got to make sure that any utilization management step therapy protocols don't become barriers to relief for these patients like Sam.
Thanks very much. Where's my list? Steve Kogan.
Great, thanks. Thanks to Samantha for teaching me so much about this condition. and best to you in the decades ahead. I look forward to your curing this disease potentially. And thanks to the experts as well who taught me so much. Now, really interesting to think about the long-term risks of the JAK drugs. And even if these risks pan out to be true, it looks like the absolute risk is pretty low. And it makes you wonder if patients might consent to bear those risks and what that means for informed consent of treatment going forward. It'll be fascinating to see how all that pans out, but let's hope we get data to be able to make some actionable decisions so that people can be informed. So thanks again for just another terrific CEPAC ICER meeting.
Great, thank you very much. Don?
Thank you, Steve. This was my first meeting as a voting member of the CEPAC, and with a nod to Steve, I have 3 points to make, each of which will be separated by an implicit semicolon. First, I come to all meetings like this with a genuine openness to changing my mind, and I actually did that about the questions concerning the clinical evidence based on things that I heard Dr. Rind and Ms. Bittner or David and Samantha say, so I want to thank the two of them for their persuasive contributions to this discussion. As somebody who comes to this work from the cystic fibrosis community, I really enjoyed the opportunity to explore what to me looks like a mirror image of cystic fibrosis, which is a life-shortening orphan disease. And I really found it reassuring, the openness and collegiality of the dialogue among all of the stakeholders, all the way from the drug manufacturers to the patient representatives and the economists and folks from the payers. And finally, I just want to say I'm a little disappointed that we didn't spend more time responding to the comments of Consumer Action and PIRG about rebate walls, because that seems to me to be an important policy challenge that has the unfortunate potential to make civilized, thoughtful discussions like this almost irrelevant because of games that get played outside of discussions like this. So thank you all for welcoming me to the New England CEPAC, and thank you for this very interesting day.
All right, great. Thank you very much. Greg.
My thanks to everyone. This has been a great conversation, and in an age of incivility, it's wonderful to discuss such difficult topics with such a great group of people. I'm struck when I spend too much time in economic models that, boy, this is still a lot of money. I was looking up what are comparable prices in life, and I found high-end Maserati leases are in this same category. And so, you know, it's tough that you can have an economic model that says something's good value, and it's still just a level of inaffordability that, unfortunately, the third-party payers are inserted between the doctor and the patient almost unavoidably once this price is set. And so I just want to be careful when we're shaking our fist at the payers that I think somebody else put them in the middle of this by the nature of where the price was set, which is tough, but thanks.
All right, thank you. Kim Lambs?
It was a perfect setup having Greg's comment and then transitioning to me, Steve. Thanks, Greg. So thank you so much, Samantha, Michelle, Wendy, for bringing the patient perspective. As everyone said, it brought so much to this conversation. From the payer's perspective, I think it is important for us to keep in mind that we have rational step therapy based on the patient individual considerations that need to be brought to each case. And as Greg was saying, and I know that Jeffrey mentioned this as well, I think that this therapeutic area is expanding, and whether or not the manufacturers believe rebates are the route that we should be going down, we need to work together to provide the broadest access to patients that is financially possible with the payer system we have today. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Kim. Leslie.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much. This was really a wonderful day. I was really struck, Samantha, by all the experiences that you have had over your life that you shared with us today. And I just hope that we can continue to incorporate the patient's voice when we're determining value of these new innovative therapies. I really am looking forward to us to continuing to do that.
Great, thank you, Leslie. Jean?
I learned so much as always, and thank you, and especially thank you to Samantha and the other patient representatives. So I'm usually the cost hawk on these, and today I was the safety hawk, because I'm concerned, especially because of the heterogeneity, that we're asking people across all parts of their lifespan, including somebody at, like Samantha, early in adulthood, to make decisions without adequate information about the long-term implications to their health. So, but I will cheerfully reverse those votes on net health benefit as soon as there is a clear safety signal, so that somebody like Samantha could say, oh, I can accept this risk or not that risk, but please let's get them something and their providers, something that they can base those decisions on, because there's so much promise. Though I agree with Greg that he kind of took my usual thunder, and I'm glad he was there to do so. So thank you all.
Thank you, Jane. Jason?
Thinking it's probably this Jason given the alphabetical order, yes. So I'll take it.
Sorry about that.
No problem. Thank you, Steve. Thanks to everyone. Echo all the sentiments of my colleagues. I'm always struck by in these meetings how much I learn, as Jean said, but also that while we think about similar issues and from meeting to meeting in terms of long-term value for money and access and equity and the role of patient perspectives and patient identified outcomes and clinical evidence and real world evidence, we get to see each time just the really, you know, specific context dependent manifestations of these big questions our health system faces for pharmaceuticals or elsewhere, for diverse conditions, for diverse and specific populations, and what's really at stake. And that's what I always leave these meetings with, informed and enlightened and re-energized to think about, why these issues matter so much, not just at a population or policy level, but at the level of patient care. And the conversations we have here with so many voices around the table, around the virtual Zoom table, are so important to that. But I'll just close by echoing Rob Azzaltine's point about how equally important a strong, credible, transparent, trustworthy Food and Drug Administration is to helping us all think about how best to understand the pharmaceuticals in our armamentarium and how we can use them most wisely, and why I think we have reason to be concerned about the agency, and that will be to all of our peril. So thank you, everyone, for this really informative day.
Great. All right, the other Jason.
Thank you, Steve. I want to reiterate a lot of the comments of my colleagues. I just for the sake of expanding the conversation, I won't say them again, but I'm just tremendously appreciative for the comments that my colleagues have meant, just the tremendous rigor and important perspective that so many of the presenters today have brought. The thing I would like to add a little bit is that I do think part of today's conversation and the report focuses on the role of randomized controlled trials in generating comparative effectiveness evidence. And what I mean by that is that RCTs are incredibly powerful tools to generate comparative effectiveness evidence, but they have important limitations, some of which can be addressed in future trials. So one of them that we discussed today is this ability, because of the length of the trial or because of the statistical power of the trial, that they can't necessarily rule in or rule out potential rare effects, which I think is something we need to be mindful about going forward. Also, they collect different things. So today we've seen trials that have collected patient-reported outcomes, which has been fantastic. Also, sometimes trials we're seeing these days collected on economic or on utilization, which can be translated into rigorous estimates for economic models. And the last thing I'll say is that these trials, we don't see a lot of this, could collect more information about caregiver burden. That's an important consideration in our deliberations in any session, including today. And RCTs could conceptually collect a lot more information about caregiver burden so that we could say in real evidence-based ways about the contextual effects of potential therapies, not only on patients, but also on the people that care for them. Thank you so much.
Thank you a lot, Jason. Albert.
Well, first of all, I want to thank Samantha as a person with lived experience and bringing her experiences and sharing those with us. I mean, it really made the conversation very rich and very informative. One thing I do want to address is that we alluded to throughout this day around equity and access. And I felt as though that was missing, just to have further discussion around that. And so I just will hope that in the future, as we begin to look at these different meds and who's being treated, who's actually receiving the benefit and who's not. So thank you.
Thanks very much. Austin.
Yeah, the last two speakers said a couple things I was going to say. So I would love to see a broader conversation about equity and access, probably expanding across disease types and medications, not specific to one, because it's such an important issue. And the issues are systemic, and I think probably to some degree can be addressed in a systemic kind of conversation. That would require a different kind of meeting. Number two, the gap between in this disease in particular. The gap between how important patient-reported outcomes are, but how limited information we have about them is very large. It seems like patient quality of life is like almost the whole ballgame here, where there's no mortality, significant mortality difference that wasn't even modeled. And we had some information, and ICER did a great job with what was available, but I just felt like it was inadequate. We need to collect more, and Jason alluded to that as well. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, guys. Those were fabulous comments. Actually, some definite things for us to think about, and I appreciate also many of the reflections on the contributions that Sam made and others made to our conversation. I guess in my final comment, I want to say that I am that mix of kind of happy to see how quickly the innovation seems to be flowing into this space following Dupixent's approval. And to know that, because we'd heard some of the kinds of challenges that patients like Sam faced when we looked at this a couple of years ago, and there's this group of patients with severe atopic dermatitis that is just not well known to primary care doctors, to many of us as individuals, that has tremendous need for new treatments. And yet, I guess one of my questions earlier was, have we learned anything from psoriasis and RA and ulcerative colitis and all the others as we go down that same route? And I'm not sure we have, to be able to avoid at least some of the problems that patients and the system face. I go back though to the very positive example of the way that Sanofi Regeneron priced Dupixent at the beginning. But I've heard the stories. I've heard the stories of how they have been asked to increase their list price before they had any competition so that there could be more rebate to kind of share with people in the middle of the system. A process that, every time the list price goes up, patients on deductibles have to pay more out of their own pocket. And yet, so there's both hope, but there's concern. And the other thing is that this is going to be even more than psoriasis, a situation in which insurers are going to be asked to be really, really careful about who gets access to these expensive treatments, because there are so many people with dermatitis, with eczema. And so again, we mentioned it earlier, and I'm not suggesting that the clinical specialty societies haven't played a role, but I hope they really understand how important a role they have to play, because they need to define that group of patients who need these expensive treatments, and how we can tell who they are versus others who don't. Because if they don't, and if patients aren't part of that and the evidence isn't discussed, anyway, if that doesn't happen, then what the history tells us is that the employers and the payers and those who are responsible for the spend as well as the health are going to have to figure it out in ways that are going to differ one from the other, that are going to seem sometimes that they don't fit, that they're too blunt, et cetera, et cetera. So there's still a huge unmet need of clinical expertise and evidence to help us define well how we can choose those patients who should receive outstanding access to these, and that we don't just have this one size fits all, multiple step clinical kind of phase approach to everybody. Because I think that's the lesson that we're still wrestling with in some of the other areas of the autoimmune space. But I will end where many of you have, which is with the optimism that with the innovation there, that if we get serious about it and we care about those patients who are going to bear the increasing cost of health insurance as these kinds of innovations continue to flow forward, that we have a chance. If people are listening to Sam, looking at the evidence, thinking honestly about the costs and the value, I think we do have a chance. And with that, I do hope we're back in another couple of years looking at atopic dermatitis with even more questions on the table, more evidence on the table, more patients who've been successfully treated. God forbid someday we may not be able to find someone like Sam who can't find something that really helps control her experience with the condition. But I think we have some hopes of getting there. And my last request echoes the one that Jeff Kasberg said, which is that for those drug companies who have one of the most important decisions in this kind of domino chain, and that is how you set your price at launch, we understand the pressures of the rebate system. We know you have to live in a market world, but take some risks, try some transparency, work with the payer and the patient communities. And if you price aligned with the benefit to patients, you'll be between $30,000 to $35,000 a year. And I think that that is probably a handsome reward to kind of go back into future innovation and to shareholders. So I hope that we can ask them to think really concretely about how they want to align their whole company's philosophy around pricing and value as they get into this area of atopic dermatitis. So thank you to the CEPAC. Thank you to the ICER research team. Again, to our patient experts and to the others on the policy roundtable. Thanks for a great meeting, everybody. And I hope you are well and that we do eventually get the chance to meet in person again. Thank you all and have a good day.
Thank you.